Welcome back to Kong API Summit 2025. My name is Paul Nashawaty, and I am the practice lead and principal analyst at theCUBE Research for the App Dev Practice, and I'm coming to you live from the show floor of the event. I'm joined today with Ross and Peter. Hey guys, how you doing?
Fantastic, thanks for having us.
Thanks for being on. It's a really great show, really exciting times out there. The keynotes and all the sessions have been really, really exciting, really popping. Why don't you introduce yourself?
Absolutely. So nice to meet you. My name is Ross Kukulinski. I'm the VP of product here at Kong, broadly responsible for Kong Konnect. So that's our cloud platform, or now API and AI connectivity platform. I've been here about almost 4 years and been having a blast meeting with customers and getting to meet with folks like you.
Very cool. Well, thanks for being on. Peter.
Hi Paul, this is Peter. I am the co-founder of OpenMeter, and since joining Kong, I'm the product manager of the Kong API and AI monetization product.
Well, I appreciate you being here too. I mean, OpenMeter's been a topic of a lot of conversation, so this is great. So let's jump in, right? I mean, there's been a lot of announcements, there's a lot of ways of how we monetize these APIs. Just jumping right into the easy questions, right? How do we monetize these APIs? How do we do in this? How are we leveraging this relationship? Peter, let's start with you.
Yeah, so I think there's a big shift happening in industry now with AI becoming kind of the de facto for companies. I think last year we have seen, in the last 2 years actually, companies rushing into launching AI features, and now companies want to see a return on that. So I think now we see this shift in the mindset that companies thinking about how we can monetize that. And the obvious answer, which we see lots of leaders like Jensen talking about, that token is becoming the currency, or is already the currency to monetize AI. So that's kind of the answer to the AI monetization. But lots of these AIs are powered by APIs. So API monetization always going to be there and go hands on hand. And we see kind of a third pillar growing up, the success-based pricing, which also API driven, but more about based on the outcome of certain action. So like, we mostly see this being popular for like support agents or sales agents when the pricing happens based on how successful those are.
No, I mean, absolutely. And Ross, I want to come to you, but I want to ask you about the context of usage monitoring, flexibility, you know, the real-time ability to boot billing and unlock those like release features. So how does that impact with what we're seeing here?
Yeah, I mean, you know, API monetization has kind of been a thing for, I don't know, 10 years
sure.
now. But when we met with customers, like most customers didn't actually want direct monetization. They were doing sort of indirect access management. Can a given customer or a partner have access to a set of APIs? And so we've had support for that in Kong and in our gateway for a long time. But the shift that we've seen, as Peter was mentioning, this rise of AI and the need to get the value out of the investment you're making there, we realized that we really, really needed a deep metering and monetization. Ultimately,
yeah.
Billing and like AI billing and AI revenue is ultimately a metering problem.
Yeah.
And so while obviously we have built direct integrations with our API and AI gateway with the new metering and billing product in Konnect, we also knew that it was going to be really important to have this universal ingestion engine. Customers are going to have other events they need to meter and understand and attribute revenue to and generate revenue from those experiences. And it's not only API traffic. And so when we looked at the broad segment of what are all of the companies that are building products and technology or open source technology in the metering and product catalog and billing space, we did a very in-depth search. And there was one company in one technology stack that sort of checked all of those boxes. You know, built on open source, solving a universal metering catalog, being able to handle the performance and throughput of the number of types of events, and then having the sort of actual flexible product catalog and billing engine. And that was OpenMeter, and that was Peter and Androth and that team. And so it started as a, hey, should we use this technology? And then the more we got to know Peter and the team, and I got deeper with the technology, we realized it was a better together story. We wanted to bring all of the capabilities of OpenMeter and build those into Kong Konnect, our cloud platform, and obviously bring the team with it. We wanted that expertise.
Of course, yeah.
You know, Kong brings opinions to our customer conversations, and we wanted to bring that expertise around these types of problems and challenges, and bring that expertise into Kong so we can both build great products and also advise and coach and guide customers on this journey.
Yeah, it makes a lot of sense. And then when I think about, you know, the tech stack, and I think about the evolution, you're right, this has kind of been going on for a long time, right? It's not something that's new, like, per se, but like the new use cases are coming up, right? The AI use cases. And there's different maturity levels for organizations. They can enter it at any level in their maturity. So I guess when I think about the real-time metering, right, that's like one of your kind of latest announcements from this event. Why is that important to, versus what was working in the past?
Yeah, it's important for two reasons that are very interconnected. So AI is very expensive from infrastructure perspective. It's a lot more expensive than what the industry is used to from the SaaS profit margin perspective. So companies want to have a very tight control on that. And that's true on both on the vendor and the customer side. So the vendors want to have real-time metering because they want to have governance in place. They want to be able to control or even stop the traffic of the certain features. But on the other end, the customers, for the same reason, want to see the consumption in real time. They want to be able to take an action in their agent, in LLM, and they want to see that immediately reflected in both their usage and kind of the estimated cost. And that's only possible on both sides with real-time metering.
And that would... I would guess that would literally depend on the use case, right? So if the use case was looking for specifics, there's flexibility to not have real time, to have asynchronous and synchronous metering, right? Would that be the case? Or
so there's definitely a trade off when it comes to metering. So when we talk about real time, we are talking about on a second-ness real time, not like on a millisecond real time. It's not like we are shooting rockets into the atmosphere. So some engineers probably would be mad at us that we call this real time.
But the analogy. Yeah.
For vendors and customers, 1-2 seconds of real timeness is feels immediate when they look into the consumption.
Sure. All right. So then let's talk about flexibility, because flexibility is another key aspect, right? So when we look at flexibility, data driven products and rate cards, that's kind of a new announcement. Why is that important?
So one of the things, and I have a fun job, so part of my responsibility is just operating the Konnect platform for our customers. So I need to deliver metering and billing of Kong usage for Kong's customers.
For your customers, yeah.
So I am basically going to be a consumer, a customer of this product,
right,
to offer that as a world-class experience. And then obviously we're also offering this now to customers. But one of the problems I have in my role as sort of product is I want to experiment with how I'm thinking about pricing and packaging. Especially with new products like AI, we need to experiment. And actually your cost changes drastically. And so what we saw was that, as part of our broad market look at this space, was that, there are many billing systems that are tightly integrated into the engineering code base. So if you want to change your pricing and packaging, submit a Jira ticket and wait for your engineering team to change something to actually have that reflect. Whereas what the OpenMeter team have done is they've decoupled. There's metering, tell us what events have happened that might matter, but then the feature definition, the entitlements, which we should talk more about, entitlements of enforcement, and then the product plans and catalogs can be developed and managed externally. So I can rework a product catalog. I can introduce a specific customer pricing plan in the Konnect metering and billing product without paging any engineers, without sending any Jira tickets. Now I can still do API-driven for all of this, right? So Kong's API-driven, so we want that information to be declarative configured. We want to have control and governance around that.
Yep.
But we've given a UI experience through OpenMeter and now in Konnect to do that in a decoupled way.
Okay.
So your product PM or your platform team or your finance team can experiment and try new pricing plans, see what that effect would have, and then decide when to roll that out and for which customers.
That makes sense. Now, are there the practitioners that are using this, are they mostly concerned about this, or is it really coming from more the procurement side of saying, well, we have to put costs in place? And this question comes from when I talk to the DevOps teams, a lot of times DevOps teams are I don't really care. I don't pay for the budget. I don't care if things are on. Just push the big green button and things go out the door. Not that I'm saying anything bad about DevOps teams. I love you guys, but at the end of the day, sometimes budgets matter in different parts of the organization. So do you see that? And also with that said, I think that relates to the entitlements and the flexible granularity and add-ons as well.
Yeah, I mean, I think part of it is app dev teams, they don't want to build and write billing software, and they don't want to update it every time the PM or the finance team wants to change something.
Right.
So for them, it's sort of developers, I used to be a developer, but I'm lazy when I'm developing. If I can just send the event, this thing happened, or this object was created, or this, this customer got this value event out of, and I can just fire that event off as an engineer, I'm not going to be asked to rework it again 3 months later or 6 months later as we change prices. So I think that's one angle to it. But you've also, obviously, you've spent a ton of time with customers you have on the OpenMeter side that will be coming to Kong. You can probably share some insights there.
On the entitlement, it's really interesting. If you look into the pricing page of any kind of late stage startup in the kind of infrastructure space, what you are going to find is a very, very long pricing page. Obviously on the top, you will see like a single price. It looks simple, but when you start to scroll down, you will see a bunch of check marks, axes, usage limits, overages, lots of entitlements basically. So kind of the modern billing, because of the modern pricing and COGS, especially with AI, is so kind of buttoned down. So it only works until the customer is in those kind of ranges. That's why I think entitlement is also becoming a lot more important in the modern age.
So, okay, so that's interesting. So you're talking about pricing, you're talking about consumption, right? What does this mean for invoicing? What does this mean for, you know, generating invoice at on cycles or on demand? Can you know exactly what you're spending at any point in time?
Yeah, and when it comes to entitlements, most companies go down in a route that is this pricing metrics. I am going to either monetize it, I'm going to set a price on it, or I'm going to set a limit on it because I made my calculations that I will be profitable in this range. So the entitlement usually doesn't show up in the invoice because that's when you decided you are not pricing that, you are controlling that. And when you price something, the invoice is going to look like that. For every single price that you have and the usage, there will be a calculation there. Some models are more complicated, like volume-based or package-based models, but eventually you will see a line item for every single usage-based price.
No, I think that's important, right? Because especially when you have different, different personas, but different organization types that are looking at how to use your APIs and such, they want to know exactly how to bill and charge back as well.
I think there's a number of different use cases here too, right? So obviously, we have the sort of late stage infrastructure startup,
yep,
or even late stage, SaaS companies, yep, that are moving from seat-based billing to more usage-based or outcome-based,
yep,
billing.
And these are usually SaaS service use cases.
Yes. So that's certainly one segment of customers, and,
yep,
like, we're excited to be able to support those. But also when we think about Kong's more traditional, either very developer-centric or larger enterprises, there's internal showback, there's,
sure,
direct chargeback internally within departments, and then you have the whole partner ecosystem. I look at customers that are in our in airline industry, for example, loyalty programs and partner programs and data sharing. Same goes for insurance and finance. Being able to share the access to partners and be able to actually understand their usage patterns and support your business with it, right? So both API and now AI, attributing the business value out of that. So I think the use cases for things like invoicing, it's not just charged through Stripe. It might be submit to their NetSuite, or it might be some other sort of more enterprise ERP system too.
So do you have a dashboard and an analytics view? I know I was looking at one of the demos. I mean, what does that look like?
Yeah, so I mean, the OpenMeter and now Konnect metering and billing has essentially per customer, seeing the customer lifecycle,
nice,
and invoicing experience.
Yeah.
And then I think as we start working more with customers, we're going to be looking at what sort of more reporting mechanisms will a CFO want, or a sort of VP of finance. I think a lot of having do this internally at Kong, most of the time we're exporting that data into some data lake, S3 or Snowflake or something, and then we have other reporting tools that our finance team uses.
Yep.
And so the flexibility of being able to export data, invoice data, out to another system is ultimately going to be what those finance teams are going to want to use and drive off of.
Very cool, very cool. So there's a lot here. I know this is a press release just came out. Where can the audience go? Where would you send them to learn more?
Number one, so we have there's a blog post live, as well as a new page for the Konnect metering and billing. So that's probably the best place to go. We are going to be launching beta next month, so you can sign up for early access. Augie said there's 50 access points for 50 people who are let into that beta. So sign up now. I haven't checked it yet today, but we're probably past that. But definitely sign up. Beta coming in November, and we're looking to target general availability for this capability by the end of the year.
Very cool.
So it's incredibly fast integration. And kudos to Peter and the entire OpenMeter team for joining forces. And there's a whole lot of Konnect engineering and design teams that have made this possible in record time.
It sounds like it's been incredibly innovative, so it's awesome. Ross, Peter, thank you very much for your time today. This has been awesome. It really is. It's great having you on the show and having you on theCUBE.
Fantastic. Thanks for coming to Summit.
Thank you. And thank you for watching. I'm Paul Nashawaty, and I'm coming to you live from the show floor at Kong API Summit 2025 on theCUBE, your leading source for tech news.